We are at the Church of the Beatitudes, which is on the northern side of the Sea of Galilee. It's built on top of a site that was established in the 4th century. And I wanted to bring you up here because this is the possible location of one of the most famous sermons that Jesus ever spoke. In Matthew 5, verses 1, it says, "Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him." And of course, we know this as the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, whether it happened exactly here or somewhere near here, the geography of the area fits the description of the Bible very closely.
It has fantastic gardens. As soon as you walk up, you're just greeted by these flowering bushes and trees and shade, and the rest of the hillside doesn't have that. So to walk up to such an incredibly beautiful place is special.
This area would have been very important for Jesus. Not only did he live here, but there's a strategic importance as well. The Via Maris ran from Egypt all the way up to Mesopotamia. And so anybody traveling through this area would have listened to the teaching of Jesus or heard some of the stories about some of the things he did and would have been able to carry the news of that throughout the world.
Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, Matthew takes up 3 chapters to cover that, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Luke also takes up quite a bit of the beginning of his gospel. And there are a lot of people that have talked about what that sermon meant. There's some people that view Jesus just as a political revolutionary. There's some people that see him as just a good moral teacher like Aesop and his fables. But really, Jesus doesn't leave any room for those kinds of ideas. He's not speaking as just another teacher. He's not speaking as a rabbi. He's speaking with authority. In chapter 5, you have him repeatedly say, "You've heard it said, but I say to you." And then when you get to chapter 6, he's helping them understand that there's a difference between how people are practicing their religion to be seen by others and how you really need to get to the heart of things. Over in chapter 7, he puts himself in a position of being able to judge at the end of time. He set himself up as much more than just a man. To read through his sermon, you can't just go through and say, well, this is a list of good things to do, or these are good suggestions. Jesus is speaking from a position of authority, which makes him to be divine. All the way through the Sermon on the Mount, he's trying to explain what it looks like when people belong to his kingdom, this spiritual kingdom, starting with the Beatitudes, what it means to pray, making sure you do things with your focus on heaven and not trying to please men, the golden rule, which almost everyone is familiar with, and then he closes it with a 3-part invitation, and that last part is where he's challenging people to think about what they're building their lives on. Are they going to build their lives on anything other than God, which is like building your house on sand, or are you going to build your life and your house on the authority of Jesus and his teaching as the Son of God? And if you do that, you're like someone who builds your house on a rock that's going to be able to weather whatever kind of storm life may throw at you.
I would have loved to have been in the audience. When he got through, they were amazed at his authority.
To think about being at the top of the mountain from Jesus' perspective and looking down and seeing all these people that were so spiritually hungry finally being fed is just overwhelming. And the fact that we're able to sit at his feet today and experience the exact same thing, no matter where we may be sitting or no matter where we may live, we can experience the exact same teaching.
At the very end of the Sermon on the Mount, it says that he left the mount and he went down to Capernaum. And if you look over my shoulder, you can actually see Capernaum just down the hill from where we are. It's a wonderful illustration of what we read in the Bible.
I'm Craig.
And I'm Stu, and we're the founders of Appian Media.
We really hope that you've enjoyed the content that you've just seen. This was only made available through the generous donations of so many of you.
We believe that the world should have biblically accurate, visually engaging content about the Bible, and it should be free for everyone.
We would encourage you to visit the membership page of appianmedia.org and consider becoming a reoccurring member. Everything that you donate to Appian Media is tax deductible.
However you decide to donate, we really appreciate your support.